Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi ta'ala wabarakatuh and a very good morning. Yang berbahagia Tan Sri Datuk Seri Utama Arshad Ayub, Chairman Board of Directors, University of Malaya, the University of Malaya Top Management, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the CEO Tech Talk third series entitled Global Entrepreneur by Yang Berbahagia Tan Sri Dr. Muhammad Irwan Serega Abdullah. Ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, I would like to invite Professor Dr. Rafina Yasmin Othman, Associate Vice Chancellor, Industry and Community Network, and Director of UM Center for Innovations and Commercializations, UMCIC, on stage for the opening remark, and then after to introduce our speaker, Yang Berbahagia Tan Sri Dr. Muhammad Irwan Serega Abdullah.
Thank you very much, Mr. MC. Assalamualaikum, salam sejahtera, selamat datang saya ucapkan kepada barisan pemimpin tertinggi Universiti Malaya, terutama sekali yang berbahagia Tan Sri Datuk Seri Utama Arshad Ayub, Pengerusi Ahli Lembaga Pengarah Universiti Malaya. Selamat datang saya ucapkan kepada para tetamu kehormat dari dalam dan luar universiti serta para hadirin sekalian yang dikasihi. Pihak Universiti Malaya dan UMCIC mengalu-alukan kehadiran semua ke CEO Tech Talk siri ketiga pada hari ini. Izinkan saya meneruskan sesi ini dalam bahasa Inggeris dengan izin. A very warm welcome to everyone. So I hope everyone's happy to be here. Really happy to be here? Okay, great, because we have an exciting program for you, and especially to all our budding and aspiring entrepreneurs, whether you're a student, whether you're an academic staff, UMCIC welcomes you, and UM celebrates your enthusiasm and your presence here today. So we have a lot of guests as well from other universities, and we're very happy to welcome to University of Malaya. Please enjoy our campus and our hospitality, and we are always welcome for your presence onto our campus. So I trust everyone is thrilled to be part of today's exciting program, and we're really happy to have an equally inspiring individual who has taken his time off to be with us today. So I'm not going to do any more talking today because I'm sure you can't wait to be listening to, and I'd like to introduce and present to you Tan Sri Dr. Muhammad Irwan Serega Abdullah. Tan Sri, welcome to University of Malaya. And here he is, the man himself. Welcome, Tan Sri.
Hi.
So here are we you? Are. We are also celebrating the 111th year of University of Malaya.
Boleh.
So today, Tan Sri, mainly graduate entrepreneurs and academic entrepreneurs. The stage is yours.
You notice the music is Kabali. The Malay version. Anyway, thanks for inviting. I think before Posaman, I had one session with the UKM students, now with the UM students. This afternoon, after lunch, we'll be talking at the Matre. That topic is on ASEAN young entrepreneurs, how to, you know, promote entrepreneurs among the ASEAN youth. And this weekend, I'm going to Indonesia. There will be this WIEF, you know, it's coming into my face, the projector. Going to Indonesia, you know, with the Prime Minister team to promote the global entrepreneurship community which I'm developing, and I'll explain later about that at the end of this session. Now, you know, I was given a topic by UM, how to be a global entrepreneur. I mean, anybody can become anything. It's all in you. It's all in you. If you really work for it, you will become a global entrepreneur, you know. And let us see, you know, some of the slides which my officers has prepared. We look at the Malaysian economy. Malaysian economy in the 70s, you know, it's only very small economy, 11 million, you know, the GDP, the size. Now it has gone to 1 trillion, 1 trillion. And the population also that time was very small, about 10 million. Now we have 30 million population. And the sectors in Malaysia is very diverse. You know, you have logistics, you can go all kind of sectors. So the economy is very diverse. Anything which you touch or any sectors you want to get involved, you can get involved. I think the slide you can move. So this opportunity, you know, in Malaysia, whatever you do, even the illegal immigrants, you know, there are 4 million, legal and illegal, 4 million of them. They are also in many businesses. They are taking away some of the opportunities which, you know, we can do those kind of businesses. So here, if you look, you know, from food, beverages, health sector, mobile application, fintech, now even the financial sectors, they are talking about fintech and so on. So there are many opportunities. Whatever you want to do, it's all in you. You just find the sectors, what you like, and get involved in those sectors. Okay, next. Again, I'm still saying it's all in you, what you want to be, know what you want to do, and mentally be prepared. The thing is that you must build the confidence in you. That's the most important thing. And always people say now, university students who are coming out of local universities, the confidence level is very low. You know, if you want to employ, you know, I was interviewing some of the GLCs and also some of the corporate sector. I'll talk to them, you know, what are their problems in employing local graduates and so on. So one of the main thing, they say confidence level. You know, the confidence level of local graduates. And also the language problem, English. This is another thing. They may understand, but to communicate, to tell, you know, what you want to tell, that's very important. You know, in a very simple manner. So the self-development part is very important. You know, you can study medicine, you can be engineer, you can be whatever, whether business studies or economics and everything. That's part of the university curriculum and everything. You learn. But how to apply, how to be in the society, that's more important, the practical part. Theory, okay, we are very good. You can, some fellas, you know, score 11 A's at SPM. But 11 A's, it doesn't matter. So what? You know, I didn't get 11 A's, you know, but I'm doing good. But the way you develop yourself, that's very important. How you relate your studies to the real world, that's very important. You know, you study, you become expert, it won't take you anywhere. Okay, roll. Okay, let us look at this video. It's very interesting. You may have seen it on YouTube, but never mind. Sound system, eh?
I have no arms and no legs, but I'm very thankful that I have my little chicken drumstick here. People freak out when they see me for the first time. It's so cool. I was at a water slide all by myself. Everyone obviously at the bottom of the slide is looking up and waiting for other people to come down. And here I come, and they're freaking out. They're like, you know, like this. And I was so tempted to look at myself and go, what happened? You know? There were times where I sort of looked at my life and thinking, well, I can't do this and I can't do that. And you keep on concentrating on the things that you wish you had or the things that you wish you didn't have. And you sort of forget what you do have.
And there's no point, I believe, in my life where I wish I had arms, legs, I wish I had arms, legs, I wish I had arms, legs, because wishing won't help. But what I've seen in life are just a couple key principles, and the first thing that I've seen is to be thankful. It's hard to be thankful, man. I tell you, when I was 8 years old, I sort of summed up my life and thought, I'm never going to get married. I'm not going to have a job. I'm not going to have a life of purpose. What kind of a husband am I going to be if I can't even hold my wife's hand? It's a lie to think that you're not good enough. It's a lie to think that you're not worth anything.
Okay. So this guy, Nick, he may be coming to Malaysia, you know, maybe you can go and listen to him. So, got no hands, you know, and he said, you know, only like, he called it a fried chicken or whatever, his leg, you know, flapping. So people like him, you know, with the confidence, you know, the hard work, and he's one of the motivator, you know, and freelance fellow who is talking all over the world, giving encouragement, confidence, and we have both hands, both legs, and everything we have. And we can do even better. We can conquer the world. It's all in you, you know, what you want. And the passion inside you, you must create the passion, what you want to do. Let's see if you like, you know, medicine, how you want to further develop a business in medical field, then you go for it. You go for it. Ask your friends, learn around from your friends, and so on. Friends are important. And if you don't have friends, never mind, go and attend seminars or talks like this. It's all free. You don't have to pay any single cent. Just listen. Just listen and find a leader or idol whom you can talk to or follow him. But the idol must be good, lah. I mean, if not, you will go somewhere else. And, you know, develop your skills, reading. There are a lot of materials. During my time, there is no internet, nothing. Now, everything in internet. You just Google, you find, you know, what you want to be. It's simple. It's simple. Okay.
People say you have to have a lot of passion for what you're doing. And it's totally true. And the reason is because it's so hard that if you don't, any rational person would give up. It's really hard. And you have to do it over a sustained period of time. So if you don't love it, if you're not having fun doing it, and you don't really love it, you're going to give up.
So never give up. Whatever you want to do, continue. You know, if you fail one, it doesn't mean the whole world has gone down. Fail twice, okay, try the third time. But here, you know, if your parents, if you fail, they will scold you. You, why you fail? You know, that's our culture. We need to change. Failure is nothing. Failure is not a shameful thing. You know, many people fail. Most of the fellows who are successful, they fail. Even you take the guy, you know, who went to Harvard, later you listen to him. You know, he failed. Was kicked out from Harvard, but now he's the multi-billionaire in US. So failure is not the end of the world. You cannot be ashamed of failure, and failure teaches you, you know, how to succeed. You learn, but don't keep on failing. I mean, that also a problem. You know, people give you money to do business, you fail. And then go to another institution, you borrow, you fail. And then keep on borrowing. Become subsidy mentality forever, you know, so we don't want. But if you fail, you learn from failure, where you make the mistake, how to improve. This is important, this is important. So the culture of failure is nothing bad, you know, you will improve a lot of things from failure. Okay, next.
From my part,
this is
I'm
the
just
guy.
Happy that the Crimson called me Harvard's most successful dropout. I guess that makes me valedictorian of my own special class. I did the best of everyone who failed. But I also want to be recognized as the guy who got Steve Ballmer to drop out of business school. I'm a bad influence. That's why I was invited to speak at your graduation. If I'd spoken at your orientation, fewer of you might be here today.
So, Bill Gates, you know, dropped out, but became successful billionaire. So he himself, he's saying, you know, he was invited, luckily for the graduation, you know, so that he don't influence when orientation, so many failures will be there. But anyway, joke aside, these are the people who learn from their failures, learn from their mistakes, and they improve. One of the guy who is my idol, you know, Peter Drucker, father of modern management, he's not around anymore, gone already. But the things he said, do the right thing is more important than doing the thing right, and doing the right thing. And then he said, if you want something new, you have to stop doing the same old thing. People here, they keep on doing the same thing. You won't improve. You need to change the way. Even if you're sitting in your room, some lecturers will be sitting in the same old chair, same table, same structure, same flower for 20 years. You'll be looking at the same window. You will die, you know. You won't have creativity inside your mind, innovative ideas. You need to change every 3 months and buy new flowers. Old flowers throw away. You know, at least the market there, you know, they can sell new flowers. So you create business. But what I'm saying is that you cannot keep on doing the same thing over and over again. And you need to exploit opportunities, solve problems. And let's say in a room, there are 10 fellas, you know, in a meeting room. And suddenly you ask for ideas, you know, how to resolve some problems. Let's say 9 fellas say we should go this way. This is the path to solve the problem. But one guy say, no. We need to do it differently. So you need to listen to the one fellow in the room. The majority may say, this is the path. The majority will take us to the normal way of doing things. But we need to also look at the different way, the out-of-the-box solution. And it may be the best solution, you know. So these are the things we must learn, even in classes, you know, even in classes. Most of the lecturers, you know, they will give you A+ if you repeat what they have taught you. If you slightly deviate from what they teach you, they will fail you, you know. These are the things. But in US, if you go to Stanford or Harvard, you know, if you try to argue with the lecturers, you give new ideas, he will give you A*. You know, these are the things. You cannot be in the same old mold, you know, whatever the book says, you reproduce what is in the book, you won't go anywhere. You know, these are the things which I'm telling to the lecturers, to the Ministry of Higher Education, whenever I have the opportunity, I'll say things, you know, that doing things differently will result in great things. Okay, next. You know, effective leadership is not about making speeches or being liked, but outcome is important. You know, there are many kind of leaders in this world, and leaders is the most important thing, even in any organization, in universities, in government department, in private sector. If the leader is not right, the whole organization will go haywire. So leadership is very important, the ultimate thing. And now we also have this social responsible investment. You know, you must be, you know, doing things which are good to the nation, to the society, to the nation. And that's where, you know, I also developed this concept called corporate entrepreneurship responsibility. I'm working with and all the GLCs, and together with MAGIC, I don't know whether you know MAGIC or not. Some of you may know. I'm the chairman of MAGIC, Malaysian Global Innovation Creativity Center. And what we are doing, you know, we are taking these young startup companies and try to match with some of the GLCs. For example, if the guy develops some solution for telcos, then I'll try to put him with Telecom or Axiata, so that the bigger corporates handhold these young companies, build them and bring to the next level. This is what corporate entrepreneurship responsibility. I hope, Tansri, also you can take some of the startup companies, put under your, you know, scrutiny, guide them. We need the old ones to guide the young ones. It's important. You know, some people say, oh, we young people, we think differently. We do things differently. But we need certain older generations' experience inside the new thinking. Of course, the technology and everything changes. But certain experience, you know, is vital. And the other thing, the teamwork in any organization, although the leadership is important, but the others, you know, the whole team, you must work together, the teamwork. If not, the organization won't be successful. It will collapse. Now, let us listen to Jack Ma. I don't know whether you have Jack Ma's, okay.
I told myself and told my young people, before 20 years old, be a good student. When you do entrepreneur, just learn some experience. Before 30 years old, follow somebody. Go to a small company. Normally in a big company, it is good to learn processing. You are a part of a big machine. But when you go to small company, you learn the passion, you learn the dreams. You learn how to do a lot of things at one time. So before 30 years old, it's not which company you go, it's which boss you follow. It's very important. A good boss teaches you differently. And before from 30 to 40 years old, you have to think very clearly when you're working for yourself, if you really want to be entrepreneur. When you're 40 to 50 years old, you have to do all the things that you are good at. Don't try to jump into the new area. It's too late. You may be successful, but the rate of dying is too big. So 40 to 50, think about how can focus on things that you are good at. But when you are 50 to 60 years old, work for the young people.
Okay, that's what Jack Ma said, but not necessarily we should follow him. You know, although he says, you know, from 20 to 30, you work for somebody else. But nowadays, the youngsters whom I meet, even 18 years old, they have their own companies already. You know, so things are changing. Unless you want to learn from somebody certain tricks, how to do business, maybe you engage yourself with some companies and learn, and then you build up. But some fellas, from the start, they have their own solutions and everything. They can work on it and become successful. I know one guy, Ganesh Muran, you know, just graduated engineer, and he developed his own technology, how to extract water from the ground and clean it and then supply to rural household. And he's now earning quite decent. In Sarawak, all the longhouses, he's supplying clean water. So these are the things, you know, you can do. There are many things, whatever you want to do, you know. Just touch something, you know, the business will just go. Supplying these bin bags also, now it become a trend. Going to many organizations, people like to sit on bin bags. So whatever you want to do, tudong, all kind of tudong now. You know, millionaires, tudong sellers. And, okay, let's listen to Mark Zuckerberg.
It's kind of hard. You need to be pretty headstrong about it, right? There are going to be all these challenges that come up. And I think the main thing that you need to do is just not give up, right? And kind of know what you want to do. And, you know, the best entrepreneurs that who I've met don't really start companies because their goal is to build a company. They do it because they want to make a change in the world and help people. And I think if you kind of stay true to that, and if you just focus on kind of powering through no matter what the challenges are that will inevitably come up in your path, then you'll find that there are lots of tools that are available and a lot of people who will help you build what you're building.
Yeah. Again, you know, the word never give up. Most of the fellows are saying never give up. So it's very important, you know, never give up. And do something which you are passionate of. If you go into territory which you are not familiar, if you are not a good cook, you know, then you want to go into food business, then you die. But you must go into area where You have the passion and you are good at it. And the other thing, in Malaysia, there is Tom Yum syndrome. One fellow opened Tom Yum restaurant, another fellow will open Tom Yum. Another fellow Tom Yum, another fellow Tom Yum. And you die eating Tom Yum. You know, what I'm saying, you know, you're killing each other. You're in the red ocean. If you read the book Blue Ocean Theory, you go to the blue ocean where there is a lot of opportunity. Why you want to fight? Unless you create some food where the taste is a fusion of Western, fusion of Eastern food, then the taste is different, then you will survive. Now people, you go all over the world. You can get Chinese food, you can get Indian food and everything. So you develop something different. Something different combining and everything, and it tastes so fantastic, will become a blockbuster. So start with your ideas and develop your idea, discuss your idea. In Malaysia, if you have idea, you will hold on to your idea. Idea won't take you anywhere. You know, kedekut, eh, nanti orang tiru idea saya. No, idea is nothing. But you discuss and work on idea and then test the idea with other people. It's not what you want, it's what people want. You boleh shock lah, dia boleh apa-apa. Kalau orang tak nak beli, tak laku. So you must test it with the customer. Even food ke apa ke, anything. You must test it with the people. Then only you see and you try to develop on it. Now, how to be a good entrepreneur? These are some of the things. You must have a workable idea. The ability to pitch, you know, nowadays, pitching is very important. Even my officers, I don't have much time. So when I'm on the 10th floor, when I want to go to my car on the first floor, I say, I give you the time, we are in the lift, 2 minutes, you pitch to me, and you will get the allocation. If you can't say within 2 minutes what you want to do, that's it, go to hell, you know? So these are the things you must, if you are good, within 2 minutes, you must tell what you want to do. Your project and everything. Go to the fact straight away. Don't start with mother or grandmother's story. You know, the background itself will take 5 minutes. Oh, I will kill you, man. I'll kill you. Go straight to the thing. Sir, this project, I want to do this. I need this allocation, this amount of manpower. And this is the outcome. Fantastic, let's go. 2 minutes you can convince me. But if you can't convince me, I give you 2 hours or so, you will be repeating the same thing. Same thing. That's why in my meetings, not more than 1 hour. And the meeting must be precise. You must make decision and implement. Anything more than 1 hour is a conference. You know, it's not a meeting. So we just meet, and no food. Malaysian meeting, you put nasi goreng and everything, the fellow will be eating. Only water, mineral water. You want food, you bring your own food. The other important thing, you know, is futuristic thinking. This is one subject which I'm formulating myself. I told UKM, because I'm the faculty member of CEO, faculty member of UKM. So I promised the Vice Chancellor I'm going to develop a course in September semester until January, an entrepreneurship masterclass course where I'm only going to take about 25 students. At the end of the day, all the 25 must have formed their company, running their own company. So I want outcome, the reality. You don't go to business school, you have 3,000 students, nobody becomes businessman or anything. You talk theory, you die with your theory. But what I want, whether he's a medical student, whether he's an engineering student, whether he's a lecturer or whatever, come to my class, I'll bring the expert, I'll bring the NGOs, I'll bring the real successful businessman with me to teach you, to handhold you within one semester. If you can't become an entrepreneur within one semester, 10 semesters or 4 years you study, you're so useless. And you must have this futuristic thinking. what business you want to develop. What will be the demand in 5 years' time? What kind of technology people want? And it's all in you. You know, when you talk to people, when you read, when you mingle around, you will know. Like Samsung. Samsung, you know, when they compete with iPhone, they have already 10 years program. But they will only sell bit by bit so that you guys buy. After that, it will be outdated and you buy again. You know? So these are the things. Okay, next. I mean, to be a global entrepreneur, this is a topic given. You know, I just try to find some of the, you know, points how to be a global entrepreneur. It's not difficult, but you must start with your domestic market first. If your people don't buy your things, who else? You think the outsider want to buy your things? They won't. That's the problem with Malaysia always. They will approve all kind of things. The other day, the Persatuan Pengguna Islam was telling me there was approval given to sell pistol. Somebody developed pistol. And the condition was given there, you cannot sell in the domestic market. Then, what the point of a local entrepreneur develop something you can't sell locally and you had to sell? You cannot convince other people to buy. Okay, let's look. Even, you know, you look at the product, it must be competitive in the local market. People want to buy, it must be good quality. And then simple, you know. And if it's food, it must be tasty and easy to consume and so on. And then the local market must accept your product. For example, we take Starbucks. Starbucks started in Washington, you know, Seattle. You know, somebody there, they like drinking coffee. But once, you know, it went to Europe and it went to other parts of the world, it became blockbuster. Now, some people, even in this crowd, I think you can't live without Starbucks. I don't know. So those who like coffee. So you must develop the product. Similarly, Adidas, Nike, and everything, they developed in US, and they started exporting to other countries. And we in Malaysia, we also have our own products. And our products, you know, must capture the market, like Bonia, you know, this is local product. And even our own coffee, Kopi Satu Malaysia, Kopi, I don't know what they call it, but, you know, Coffee Bean. So all this copy or anything, the product, you can develop locally and then you try to expand to international market. Of course, if you go to international market, you must get the international barcode and then you must, you know, the quality, you must ensure the quality and you must get all the approval. You know, we have many government agencies. I'm not criticizing government agencies, but we are a bit slow. We are a bit territorial. You know, everybody wants to look at their own territory, their own space. This is the problem. We need to open up. We need to cooperate. For example, halal. I've been talking about halal, you know, 10 years ago. Our Jakim logo recognized all over the world. All over the world. But suddenly, you know, they say we need another institution called HDC, Halal Development Corporation, to pull things together. And that institution start fighting with Jakim, and then start fighting with Ministry of Health in terms of health certification and so on. We didn't go anywhere. You know, we like to create institution, we like to fight each other, and we don't go anywhere. But we have all the products, we have all the ingredients, we have everything. I'm going to talk to Matrit afterward. I'm going to say the same thing. And we have, you know, the number of embassies all over the world. What the ambassadors are doing. You know, again, we need to change the mindset. The role of embassies should be more promoting our products. You know, most of our products, when I did some research, it's going through Singapore. Because Singapore has the whole network covered all over the world. And they get all the approval, HACCP, phytosanitary, all kind of approval, they got it. And They claim whatever Malaysian product, they claim is Singaporean. You know, they label it, they package it nicely. Like cut flowers, you know, the orchid flowers coming from Johor, Muar, and so on. It goes to Singapore, and they buy it 80 cents per stock, and they sell it 12 ringgit, you know, at the international market. So how many times the profit? You go to New York, you go to Tokyo, in the hotel, you see Malaysian orchids there, but from Singapore. So we need to develop this network. Network, business, contact, and so on. We can, if you want to be a global player, you need to go to international conference. You need to establish your contacts and so on. It's very important. That's why, you know, I'm creating this, created this global entrepreneurship movement, GEM. You know, I hope all of you will register. This is part of the promotion. I'm the patron of this global entrepreneurship movement. We have the president here. I don't know where is he. Dash. He has his own company called Startup Malaysia. He started his company, and he's really developing most of the startup. Maybe after this, you can talk to him. We have the treasurer. She's the treasurer, UN. Former TV3 personality. If you remember, 3R, actress. And also, she do a lot of things. She has her own NGO called Kaki Seni, which goes to the underprivileged kids and so on, giving tuition, you know, helping them and so on, doing intervention work. You know, some of our kids, youngsters, you know, if you go to Kampung Kerinci area, Pantai Dalam, the parents are so busy. The kids, you know, they just leave them. Sometimes they go to school, sometimes they go to the shopping malls and so on. And we need NGOs like this do intervention, bring the kids to the right path, you know, education, work, and so on. If they don't want to go to school, then give them skill training. You know, if not, our country, going down the road another 40 years, we will be in trouble. That's why I'm thinking of 40 years down the road. I'm not thinking now. So this global entrepreneurship movement, we are going to organize this year called Global Entrepreneurship Community. We are going to create a global community starting from Malaysia. Why? Why we need this global community? Because we need to develop the network. Whether you want to have a network in Chile, you can get a guy who is going to market your product in Chile, or in Norway, or in Bulgaria, anywhere. We are going to link the whole world as one community. It not necessarily start from US. People always think, you know, start in US will be good. There are many organizations already in US. I'm frightened these few weeks listening to Donald Trump. You know, I'm frightened, I'm holding my breath. If he becomes the president, wow. You know, US is going to go backward, you know, inward looking. We don't want. That's where the whole idea is coming, Silicon Valley and so on. If they started blocking everything, tightening things, then they are going backward. It's not good for the world. It's not good for US. I hope the US fellows understand this. But these are crazy bunch of people, you know. The voters also crazy. You won't know who they choose. But in Malaysia, it's okay. You know, we all are good people. We know who to choose. Because we think, you know, what we built for the past 40 years, the country is strong, the country is stable, the economy is good, banking system is good. You all go to university peacefully, happily. And we want this to continue another 40 years, 50 years. We don't want everything to go down. That's why it's very important to think of the nation, you know, whatever you do. Of course, doing business is good, make profit, but you must also think of the nation, the society, you know, because it's not you alone. After this, you have your kids, your grandkids, you know, your generation. If you want them to live happily, then this is the thing, way forward. you know, entrepreneurship, linking and everything. This afternoon, I'm talking about ASEAN at the Madrid, where ASEAN is very important, you know, the 10 countries, because if we look at Malaysia alone, we have only 30 million. We can't sell our products to 30 million. It's a very small market. If we talk about ASEAN, 600 million. Indonesia alone, 250 million over. So we need this linkage. That's why I'm going, you know, on Monday to launch the GEC, you know, with the Prime Minister in Indonesia so that we pull Indonesia together with us. So we link at least Indonesia, Thailand, Philippines, and so on, ASEAN, 600 million, we can market our products, even we can sell our Proton cars and so on. And then we further develop GEC in November with India, another 1 billion there. And the economy is growing, India, 7%. And the middle income in India is coming up. So they will demand for products. So we need to capture India. China, although slow down, still they are growing 6% above. So we need Chinese market. So we develop the whole network, and Malaysia can move our entrepreneurs and also other entrepreneurs from ASEAN countries, you know, prosper thy neighbor, you know, and we come up. And the whole idea is the next generation of technology should come from this region, this soil. And we have everything. The problem here is that, you know, whenever you develop, for example, Grab Taxi came from Malaysia, but it went to Singapore. Now everybody say it's Singapore, it's Singapore. Because the ecosystem is in Singapore. That's why we are developing the whole ecosystem here now to bring the ecosystem. That's why in JAM, JAM is not only an organization, it's an institution. You know, they have private sector there. They have government organization there. They have VC there. They have university lecturers there. They have students like you. Everybody come together. Everybody come together. And we together we develop. Hopefully one day, Malaysia become, you know, the center of entrepreneurship development. I think I stop here. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Tan Sri. Let's give a big applause to Dr. Tan Sri, Dr. Muhammad Irwan Serega Abdullah.
Hi. Hi. Wow. I didn't expect this thing. Thank you, thank you. You
know, ladies.
These are the things, you know. Things are changing. Youngsters like music. Youngsters like to jump. So I follow the trend. That's why I'm wearing all the yellow, Batman. Today, when I woke up, I don't know what to wear. So I was searching for the t-shirt. So I put on my Batman. My wife said, hey, crazy guy, you're going to office. What, Batman? I said, no, I'm going to a function in UM.
Thank you so much.
Ladies and gentlemen, may
so
I invite...
So whenever I'm at the magic or with the youngsters, I will become one of them. That's why, sorry, Tan Sri, you see me in suit always, necktie and so on. That's different function. Madrid, I'll dress a bit, okay? Because Madrid, okay. Now, Q&A, okay. You want to ask anything, you can ask.
I'll come up with Tan Sri here in... So we'd really like to get some feedback from. I think there's already hands come up and already Tan Sri. Look.
Okay. Whatever I can answer, I'll answer. Whatever I say, no means no lah.
Yes, Professor Ramli, an entrepreneur in halal.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Thank you, Prof. Jasmine. I'm Professor Dr. Ramli Abdullah from Science and also Pusat IHRUM, this International Halal Research in Malaysia. Thank you for your inspiring talk. I'm not young anymore. Actually,
I'm not either, but okay, young at heart.
A young at heart, yeah. I'm not also a young at heart. actually. Yeah. But I love the new and the future generation. I'm talking about the futuristic of our future generations. I think we have a lot of wealth, you know, in our country, but we never use them. You know, so what I want to say here, I'm talking about the futuristic of this young Malaysian global entrepreneurs. How do you think that they could overcome the wrong perception, the negative perception of this IS, the terrorism? I'm so worried, you know. I just had a discussion, you know, with a high authority that thought that if we want to promote halal entrepreneurs, you know, this is as a new wave, you know, this new wave in the global market. They said that we're going to promote, we want to convert Muslim in, you know, in the foreign countries. So the Muslim will get married for wives, you know, then they become Muslim, then they become terrorists. How do we face this kind of problem?
Okay.
Thank you. I want your opinion.
I mean, good question, you know. It's all perception, you know, perception. People, you know, because at the international communities, you know, let's say in Iraq or whatever is happening in the Middle East areas, so people think that is Islam. It's a wrong perception. Islam is peace, everybody knows, you know, we love people, we want to live happily. So it doesn't mean you go into halal product, you're going to convert them. Mind you, even in Malaysia, the successful organization which are running halal are non-Muslims. All the non-Muslims are selling all these halal products, number one. Number two, even the NGO organization, the fellow from Norway is having an organization here promoting all the halal products. You know, you will be surprised. All the matzaleh, and they are not Muslims, but they know the market is there. You know, trillion, you know, in terms of value for halal products. So there is nothing, even you can penetrate. That's why I'm saying in Middle East, we are not capturing the market, the halal market there. And we need to do, you know, concerted programs, and so on. And of course, about IS, Daesh and everything, we need to teach our society, you know, don't get involved. That's not the right path. Islam is peace. It's peace. You know, we want to live happily ever after and so on. And we respect other religion. We can, you know, live with Muslim, Hinduism or Christianity or anything. And this is the world we need to teach the youngsters. Because of the wrong perception given, the youngsters are also not, you know, united together. The Chinese one side, the Indian one side, the Malays one side. We need to do away with this. You know, we need to live as one nation. You know, that's why Malaysia should be the example to the world. You know, a country where we can live peacefully among many religions. You know, it doesn't matter whether you promote halal industry or non-halal or anything, but respect each other. This is the world we want to create, but unfortunately, you can't control anybody in this world. Everybody thinks they are the king. So that is the problem. Even on the road, you know, Malaysia, I was told, highest in terms of accident, death on roads and so on. And this thing we can avoid, but we are not avoiding. You know, they say during festive season in China billion, the population, but festive season only 34 deaths. You know, 34. Here, thousands of deaths, you know, Raya season. Mm. Thousands. Ooh. So the mindset. It's all mindset, perception. Hopefully, you know, Malaysia can become the example, you know, to do away with Daesh and IS and everything. It's not good. It's not good. That's why you see Donald Trump is so frightened already. You know, he want to close down immigration, close down, you know, for foreign Muslims and everything. You know, even I went to US, to the last time I went to raise sukuk, you know, and I was stopped for 15 minutes because my name got Muhammad in front, you know, so they stopped me. But the embassy side said, he's a sekjen, you know, let him go. And they said, no, we must, You know, so they pulled me 15 minutes. Luckily, 15 minutes, you know, the other guys there, 4 hours, 5 hours, you know, with Ahmad, Muhammad, two names there. So, so they are so frightened because of this thing. I mean, I don't blame them because there are guys who are creating this kind of activities which shows bad impression on Islam. You know, if everybody knows, understand Islam, the teaching of Prophet, the world will be peace, absolutely, you know, forever.
Shall we take a second question, Dasri?
Hi, good morning.
Yeah.
I'm the president of the student council for the graduate school. I have a couple of students coming up to me. They're a bit worried about the job market. There's been major layoffs in the oil and gas industry and also the palm oil industry. I guess what I'm trying to do right now is I'm trying to create a yayasan whereby we can actually get some funding via CSR. And this is actually to train these grad students to improve their soft skills. I think what is lacking is the soft skills, number one, and also the ideas for them to be entrepreneurs. We want to bring professors from Silicon Valley over to Malaysia. I mean, we have all these really great big goals. My question is, how do I start doing this yayasan or endowment to enable this to happen?
Mm. So for your information, Tansri, most of the students in the audience today, about 50% of our audience are graduate students because it's the time of year.
I mean, there are many yayasan, but you can develop, you know, just do a paper. I'm not going to teach everything, you know, but do a paper, and then you need to approach the right institution that, you know, tax-free and so on, you need to get. If not, they will tax you. So the institution who wants to donate to you also, they want to be tax deducted, whatever they donate to you. So this again, you need to come to Ministry of Finance. I don't know where is Ministry of Finance. It's me, you know, okay. So you need to come and talk to the people there, and they will guide you. I mean, it's a good idea. Hopefully you will be successful, you know, because job market is very tight. Although I'm not saying that, you know, the future is very bleak. Even like Petronas, I'm on the board of Petronas. We need 50 to 60,000 in rapid project for the next 5 years. But, you know, we need to have the right skill. You know, what kind of engineers? Whether they are petrochemical engineers, you know, civil engineers, electrical engineers, and then the mid-level technicians and everything. We are spending billions of ringgit for TVET. I don't know where the training are going on. People are saying TVET, technical and vocational education training. But the right skill, if not, foreigners will come and take the job. You know, like Forest City. Recently, I was told 60% are Chinese from China. You know, why do we need Chinese from China? Our fellows can work. So this is where, you know, we are also doing a study in the pay scale. You know, the CEOs are earning 200,000 per month, 300,000 per month, but the fellows at the mid-level and lower level, they're earning only 2,000, 1,005. Our guys don't want to work. So we need to increase the pay scale, the minimum wage to a level where even local would like to work. And of course, it must be linked to productivity, yeah. You know. These are the problems, you know, we are facing a lot of problems. Illegal immigrants, immigrant workers, and so on. We need to address this issue. Then only our fellows will move in, the salary need to go up. So a lot of restructuring exercise need to be done. That's on the job market. On your side, go all out on the entrepreneurship. Those who don't want to work with people, start your business. Like I said, there is a lot of opportunities. Whatever you touch in Malaysia, you can sell. Fella, you go during Posaman, he just put lime and everything into the water and put ice, lime water. Posa, tengok, lapa, beli. All kind of thing people buy and so on. Although you don't drink or you drink, I don't know.
So be the job creator, eh, that's right.
Yeah.
Next question. Let's have another question. From students?
Okay. I have something. Okay. You have the t-shirts? I want to give some t-shirts.
Ah, incentive.
Okay. I have here five t-shirts. You know, t-shirts. I want to give away to students. Oh, five of you. You know, if you come up here and talk with me, I'll give you t-shirt.
Come on, have a question.
Huh? No question. Just come over just here. Come. Five of you.
Okay.
Okay, one.
Umayel.
Who else?
Come.
Come, come.
You have to come down. You have to come down.
Come down. Come down here onto the stage. Student, eh? Student, eh?
Student.
Oh, lecturer pun boleh.
Student, student.
Your student. Oh,
grad student.
Student, student. Come, come. Come, student, student. Okay. Umayel. One more, one more. One more. I have five t-shirts. Okay, okay, okay. Okay.
Big hand, everybody.
Okay. Before you earn the t-shirt, so you must talk with me. So introduce yourself and tell me what kind of entrepreneur you want to be. It's all about entrepreneur.
Okay, my name is Adnan bin Abdullah Hasbi. I launched my app company 2 years ago.
Oh, wow.
I managed to actually get some funding off Cradle. And I realized one of the things which you really need is to pitch, and you have to be willing to go the extra mile. So my advice today is just be brave, go the extra mile. That's all you need.
Well, how's your company doing now?
It's doing okay.
Okay. Okay.
What app, sir?
Hijab.
Okay, yeah. Cool.
So can give, eh? Okay, okay. Okay, your name and whatever you want to be.
Okay, my name is Umayya, and I'm a postdoc. My boss is there. Prof Yasmin.
Okay.
Okay, Tan Sri, before I answer your question, I want to tell you this. Magilchi. I don't know whether you know.
That is Kabali movie's tagline. Okay, okay.
It's a popular dialogue in the film from Kabali.
Kabali,
that
yeah.
was the music that was played during the arrival of Tan Sri. Mm.
The hero comes down with the music.
Magilchi means happy.
Happy, bagus.
Happy, happy. Okay.
Okay, my ambition is not to become an entrepreneur, okay. but I want to become a scientist. So I'm not sure can a scientist, besides being scientist, well, we can be an entrepreneur, but what is so necessary to become an entrepreneur in this current situation?
I mean, even a scientist can become an entrepreneur. If you develop a product, you know, the product itself, if it's a blockbuster, you know, like, let's say you find a medicine to cure cancer.
Sure.
Then it will be a blockbuster because there is no such thing, you know, you can cure straight away. It will take time. So scientists or whatever you do, even like I know a few doctors, even my son is a doctor in Shalam, but most of the times he's with the gang doing business, all kind of business. He won't be, and he take only night shift because daytime he can do business, he say. You know, and if you take night shift, you get another extra day holiday. So he will go with this, you know, all this, they call AJ, one company, you know. So they are more on this, you get points, you buy things and so on. So they earn income from there. Another girl, you know, a doctor, but she left the job. You know, because she say she's only earning 4,000 and so on, but she's selling this hijab, you know, tudung and so on. She's earning 12,000 and staying at home some more, taking care of the kids and everything, masak and so on, earning 12,000, okay. So things are changing the way you do things, you know. You can work, you can be a scientist, you can also be a business entrepreneur. Nowadays, all you need is only this thing to do a business.
Yeah, I just tweet you.
You tweet me? Okay, okay. You know, I know one guy during these conferences, I met him, only 13 years old, got three companies already. 13 years old, you know. Those days when I was small, 13 years old, if I want to start business, my mother will kick me, you know. But nowadays things are changing. Yeah. So the thing is that not only educating government institution, private sector, you must educate your parents too. Tell your parents. Mm. That's why I need to have some session with the parents, you know. Yeah. Change of mindset of parents. How to bring up the kids. How to let them decide things. Okay. 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 You're from where?
Yeah. Assalamu alaikum.
Okay. Salam.
My name is Rashid. I'm from Nigeria. Thank for your talk. Okay. I benefited a lot. So what I want to become is to be an entrepreneur in the field of mineral resources. Particularly the industrial mineral. So currently I'm doing masters in geology. So because Nigeria has gotten a lot of mineral resources and we have not tapped a lot of them. So I wish I become an entrepreneur and promote the industrial minerals of Nigeria so that we can produce a lot of things from the resources.
Good. Great. Mm. You know? But Nigeria also, you need peace, you know? We need to bring all the people together because the country also a lot of turmoil, you know, Muslims and non-Muslims and so on. I have a few friends there. They are doing good. And I hope, you know, pray to Allah that Nigeria also will be peace, you know. Then only you can do business. Okay, next.
My name is Ghalib Ahmed Taher. I am from Pakistan. I am doing PhD in University of Malaya. And I have really enjoyed your talk. And currently, I worked in a startup company. Now I am also working in a startup company. So I can learn process. In future, I want to start my own company in. I want to build my own tech product.
Okay, good. We will develop network, you know, with Pakistan, Nigeria, yes. Through GEM, you know.
But currently, so I want my company to be
robotics.
Successful.
Okay. Are you in robotics?
Currently, we are selling the medical products. I want that to be successful.
Good. So we will create our network, you know.
Yes.
So starting today, you are my friend.
Yeah, assalamu alaikum, everyone. My name is Mohali from Nigeria. I'm from the Faculty of Business and Accountancy. I have the intention of becoming a successful entrepreneur, and I've been working on it. But I've been facing the problem of a startup. So how can I mean, what suggestion you can give to me? I mean, how can I overcome the problem of, startup?
You can start, you know, you can even enroll in some of our magic program. You can talk to Dash also. He also conducts some of the startup programs, how to start a company, where to start. There are ways, you know, they will teach you and so on. And of course, I don't want to go into the theory and so on, but it's easy. You talk to people, you know. Even you can start in Malaysia, a company. It doesn't mean you are a foreigner. You cannot start a startup company here. You can. We have startup visa. You know, we provide visa for you, 6 months, you can stay here and work here. You can talk to people from Cradle and so on, in terms of funding. And we can even partner you with the local players and so on. And you can form a company. Don't worry. After this, talk to these people. Thank you.
So startup visa, that's a new thing.
So thank you to everybody.
Thank you very much. Thank you, everyone. So that was a... Thank you. Thank you very much. That was so inspirational. I hope this is just the first of many talks that you'll come. We're very excited about
If you invite, I'll come. I don't need money or anything.
We're very excited about your entrepreneur program for students. I hope it will be available.
But this also, I postponed a couple of times, because, you know, I have a lot of things to do.
Got a lot of bosses.
Bosses and everything. Sometimes I'm human too. Sometimes I'm not well. So I need to take care of my health too. I'm not young anymore. And one day I will die too. So while I'm alive, I need to do a lot of things, bring this nation to the next level. The same thing.
Absolutely.
I preach and I beg all of you that you will do the same thing to our nation. You know, we love our nation.
I want to give just 1 minute to entrepreneur, medical entrepreneur professors or entrepreneurs here. They run a 3D printing company.
Okay. They are all successful. They are all well known. I'm a small guy. Okay.
They're brain surgeons. Oh. 1 minute.
We wish. Dr. Zainal and I have a startup, and I agree with a lot of what you said. There is, however, a problem when you're sometimes involved in high tech, and maybe you might be able to help us and help the group, everybody in the process. There's always a perception problem. You are right that we have to succeed locally, but it's very hard to get the niche in locally. It's okay if you're cooking food and doing a hijab and things like that, but if you're in technology, you're always up against a German company or an American company, and that's a huge problem. And we are not able to get the correct year, the correct platform to get what we want to do out. The second thing also is for entrepreneurship or to innovate and start up, sometimes we have access issues. There's too many layers to get things out to the top. And sometimes people only understand some basic concepts. And sometimes you want to pitch something a little bit more complicated, it is a bit difficult and to access to the correct person. So we, for example, have found it's easier for me to convince an American company or a Singaporean company to do what we want to do than to convince Malaysia. And maybe that's one of the reasons why things get marketed out of Singapore, for example, the thumb drive.
Okay.
You know, so is it true we don't celebrate our own success enough, Tan Sri?
Yeah, that's one thing. The problem, you are a doctor, isn't it? Yes. Even our doctors are a problem, you know. Our doctors, the mentality. You know, when I talk to even Ministry of Health, the doctors there, they always, you know, they recommend foreign products. You must change the mindset of the local doctors, you know, even UM hospital or whatever hospital. For example, the bed, hospital bed. There are local companies producing hospital bed. But the hospital, they don't want to buy from the local producer. They say our bed, low quality, cannot do this, cannot adjust this. But when I talk to the producer, they say, you tell me, I can build it and adjust it. Even hospital bed we are importing. You know, it's not rocket science to build this hospital bed. And medicine, again, there are many kind of medicine we produce locally. Still, we want to import, and billions of ringgit we are buying from overseas. So we need to change the mindset. Everybody, the fellow who at the counter doing purchasing, the doctors who recommend, all these things, doctors who recommend, you know, not me. I just provide the money. But you need to change the mindset. Same thing in schools, the teachers, the education materials, and so on. So we need to convince everybody. Start, buy local, whatever product you produce. If there are some, you know, some lack of quality, you can adjust. You know, in terms of pricing and so on, ask them to improve. It will take time, you know, because we are starting from you know, a lower level, whereas US, Germany, they've gone very far ahead. So a lot of catch up to do. But having said that, even some of the local products are better than the US product. That one we need to convince and educate the local fellows, especially the guys who are in charge of procurement. You know, we need to educate, bring them here, give them a lecture.
Okay, we will do that. Okay. Definitely. Okay. I think it's time to celebrate local technology, local success. And thank you so much, Tan Sri.
Thank you.
Again, let's have a big round. Thank you so much.
Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, thank you to Yang Berbahagia Tan Sri Dr. Muhammad Irwan Seraga Abdullah and Professor Dr. Revina Yasmin. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, with that, we would like to invite our honorable guests, ladies and gentlemen, to proceed to Exhibit Hall downstairs for the launching of UM Creative Publications by UMCIC and Qatar Centre. And after that, for Jamuan Hari Raya Aidilfitri 2016.
So we have a...
And remember, 1st and 2nd November, KLCC, Global Economic Community. You know, all the speakers we are bringing from Silicon Valley, from all parts, and we are bringing from all sectors, whether you are in medical, in fintech, or logistics, halal, there will be speakers, celebrities, whoever, and the Prime Minister is officiating. I hope you will benefit. It's free. You know, I'm doing it free. You know?
Fantastic, that's free. So this is a chance. So register outside with GEM and get yourself on the mailing list.
Okay.
So we'd like to welcome you downstairs, that's free, for okay. one
and,
of our
And
successes.
If you register with GEM, every month there is a talk. You know, free, conducted by professional. The first we had the Malaysian Business Angel. That is an association, Business Angel. They go and invest in your startup companies. They had their first session. And last week we had our Hari Raya Jam, and we had creative industry, those who are in performing arts and creative industry for them. So every month we have free lectures for you, whatever area you want to get involved in. Thank you.